All right, so Bard has been out for quite a while now, and just this week, they've updated it to basically be able to do code. So one of the things that disappointed a lot of people when the public version of Bard first came out was it couldn't do code. Now, actually, the internal versions have been able to do code from the start. The challenge that Google has is being able to serve models to people at scale. And therefore, that means they have to create smaller versions of the model and can't use the full size version. So just yesterday, they've released this version that allows you to use code. They also, along with this, they released a blog post by the wonderful Paige Bailey. And it just talks a little bit about what this is. So what I thought we'd do is just jump in and have a look at how it works and some of the key things. So there are three sort of main things that it can do. It can sort of help you write code. It can explain code, can even go into different GitHub repos and explain those for you as well. So this is what you're presented with when you start out. You can see if we come in here and we ask it, okay, let's do something really simple. Can you write me a Python function that checks if a number is prime, please? So it will generate very quickly. The speed of generation on Bard has gotten a lot quicker for this version. And you can see here, we've basically got our function. It's written in Python, and we could copy and paste this to wherever we want. The other big advantage, though, that they've added in here is this ability to export this to a Colab. So we're able to then come in here and basically just click this and say export to Colab. And you'll see that now it will save the Colab in your Google Drive. And now I can just open up the Colab and voila, the code is there. So I can come in here, I can run it. I will put in one of these examples one at a time, just because we're using Colab in here. So it's just connecting and getting me a simple machine. And you see now it's basically a run this function and I can use it to check if numbers are prime or not. So it's pretty nice when you can do that. So that obviously that's really simple. Let's see if we can get it to do something that's a little more complicated. So one of the things I've been doing is preparing some videos around LangChain and SQL. So I wanted to set this up in a Google Colab. So what I thought is, okay, I come in here and I want to basically generate a SQLite database for me. And I want it to basically have a table called people. I want to populate that with some random things, random data in here. So here's, I've just written my prompt here. Okay, so you can see my prompt that I've written here. Can you write a set of Colab cells that creates a SQLite database, make the table called people, then populate that with random people and include fields, name, age, gender, and favorite ice cream flavor? So this will basically go through and generate the code for this. So we can see that, okay, this is all good. It's given me what I want from here. Of course, I could just come down here and I could open this into Colab. But really what I want is, on top of this, I want to be able to have the ability to query it. So let's get it to write some queries. How would I query this with SQL queries? And you can see that it's generated the SQL queries. Now, actually, I really wanted them in Python, not just in SQL like this. So let me come in and I'll just type in, how would I write these in Python? And so it's going to basically take the SQL queries that I had there, and it's going to give me the Python data for this. So now I've got something that I want to open in Colab. So I'm going to just come down here. I'm going to say export to Colab, open this up, connect to the Colab. So I actually need the data to create it. So I've just copied that across. Let me just bring this in and post this in here. And I can already see that there's going to be an error. If you look at this, we've got port SQLite 3, and we can see that we're already getting some sort of warnings here that, okay, this function rendering is not in there. So let me just run this. I'm going to get an error. Now I actually know what this error is, right? I just need to import rand in from random up there. But let's say I don't know what that is. So I can come back into Bard and I can type in the code. So I've done it once, but here, let me do it again. So I can put in this code. Then I can say I got an error and then the name. So you can see as I posted this in, it's lost its formatting, but it's worked out that, oh, okay, no problem here. I can fix that error for you. So you see what it's actually done is now imported random. And rather than just use rand int, it's using random int. So let's go back to our Colab, replace that code. Now, one of the challenges, it would throw an error here, is that we've already got this database, so I just need to delete out because we don't want to create it twice. And now if I come in and we can see, okay, that ran. And then now I can go through each of these and we can see, okay, the average age, it's basically giving us the average age there. I'm counting the number of people. It's written all the code for counting the number of people, counting the number of females, all of these things that I asked for in the original one. And getting the most popular ice cream, it's basically giving us this. And you'll find that actually one of the things I didn't show is that for each of these things, you can get different versions. So we could actually do this. So this is basically added in someone. Now, I want to come back to Bud and I'm going to ask it just to basically, how can I print out a full table as Panda's data frame in here? So let me just put this in. Okay. And so here I can look at the drafts for this. This is kind of what I want. I can go through the different drafts and I can say, well, we don't really want to make it again from scratch. What we want is something that where we can just take it and put that in. So let's try this. There, it's done. It's basically printed each of the people and we've gone through and seen what their values are, etc. So the interesting thing is, like, you will always get the text boxes as well. So you could make use of them. This is very cool if you're just learning to code or you're looking to code something that you're not really sure of. At the moment, it only supports Python in Colab, but in Bud itself, it is being able to support other languages as well. All right, so here's an example of a way I was using it before, that I basically gave it a repo, and this repo is an implementation of the Col T5 attention that's underway. And I think it's actually quite new. I'm not sure even how much of it's been done. Yeah, there's still stuff to be done in here. But this is done by Phil Wang, who's done a lot of really cool stuff on GitHub. And we can come in here, we can look at Bud, and we can say, okay, can you tell me about this repo? So let's say I didn't know what this particular thing was. It goes in and basically tells me a little bit about the repo. It tells me what paper it relates to. That's something that's kind of interesting. And then it basically tells me some of the features that are coming and stuff for this. And so from that, I can also then take that paper. So I just basically copied this archive paper in here and say, okay, explain this paper to me. And so this paper basically is a form of attention where they're basically trying to get longer sequences, just a very simple overview of it. And you can see, sure enough, this is basically then able to come in and basically tell me that this paper begins by discussing the limitations of traditional attention. It goes through what the sort of gist of the paper is. Now, I would say be very wary about just relying on this. They can hallucinate things, but often you're going to get good results that springboard for you to then start off from. So then I asked it, okay, what are some other types of attention out there for transformers? It gave me some really sort of standard stuff here. And then I asked it about flash attention. And so here it's basically told me about flash attention, when it was created, and it's given a source as well. So you will see sometimes when you're asking for code things, it will actually give you a source for where the code comes from. If it comes from an open source project or something like that, that's something that they will tell you about and give you a link to as well. So in this case, it's giving us a blog post to this. Let's just check that this is real. Yes, it's real. It's one of the ones that I've looked at before. Then the interesting thing here was then I asked it, okay, can you write me a simple implementation of flash attention in PyTorch? Now, it doesn't do a great job here, all right? Actually, what it's implementing is from a totally different paper. So it's implementing from this transformer quality in linear time, and it's actually getting it wrong. This paper is actually a paper from Quoclay's team at Google. So it's a different paper that they're looking at. The original flash attention paper is this paper. But anyway, you can see that it's on the road to where we would like it to go. You need to be wary of some things, but if you're looking to try and code something, you can do that straight out. We can even ask it about things like, you know, if we ask it, what is LangChain? You'll see that, okay, it understands that LangChain is an app for building applications for large language models, and it's got a bit of detail about it. You could try, I've tried writing a little bit of code with LangChain with it and not to great success, but my guess is that will get better over time as LangChain is moving so quickly. That's probably also an issue in here. I'm not sure how often they're indexing relevant data to bring in here and how much it's actually referencing data on the web in real time versus just from the model or some kind of database system that they're looking up in. Anyway, this gives you a sense of, you know, what this thing can do. and come in and have a play with it. If you've got access to Bard, if you don't have access to Bard at the moment, it is being rolled out. A lot of people in Google are working very hard on getting it to work, at least in countries where they have data centers and where they can serve this model. And then over time, they will basically be rolled out to everyone. So as always, if you've got any questions, please put them in the comments. If you found this video useful, please click like and subscribe. I will talk to you in the next video. Bye for now.